Welcome to Convocation.
My name is Celia Benson. I'm the director of Convocation. Welcome back. We have a good crowd today. You may have noticed we generally rope off the back section of chairs, and we do that in order to make it a little bit more personal. This is a huge concert hall, and there are only about half as many students enrolled in the class as we have seats. So we want you to scoot forward. We don't rope off as many as we probably should, so we invite you to come in and come to the front of the class so that you don't feel so spread out. Get to know your neighbor, okay? Make friends with each other. You might meet somebody new, make a new friend. So, and then it's just easier for the speaker also so they don't feel like they're speaking, you know, to the back 40 back there. Okay, if you're taking the class for credit, don't forget to take your the student agreement on Canvas. That's your first assignment for the class, all right? Most of you have already done that, so good job, everybody. Also, don't forget to, starting today, bring your student ID card so that you get credit. Way to go, coming in quickly and scanning your card. You'll have to do that every week. Also, some of you have already liked us on Instagram. Don't forget to do that after class at Snow Convocation. We'll be giving you regular updates on what's going on in Convocation. Now, please take out your phones and turn them off or silence them so they're not a distraction. Next week, we will have Liz Shropshire. She's the founder and the president of Shropshire Music Foundation, and she'll be talking about peace through music and some of the work that she's done throughout the world teaching music to children of impoverished countries and countries that have been torn through civil wars and different effects of war. Okay, this week, we are celebrating and commemorating Martin Luther King Jr. Day. And we're gonna start with a special music number by Ane Unu and Friends. They'll be performing a song. And then following that, Taylo will be introducing our speaker. But I just want to announce that tonight at 6 p.m., you may have received a flyer when you walked in. We'll be holding the annual Martin Luther King Day walk. So join us at the plaza at 6 o'clock for hot cocoa and our annual Martin Luther King walk. So I'm going to turn the time over now to Ane Unu and Friends for music. Please welcome them.
Hello. How are you? I'm good too, thanks for asking. Okay, so preliminary, the name for the group that you see before you is The Homies. So say hello to The Homies. Okay, great. We're gonna perform a song entitled We Shall Overcome, which was one of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s favorite hymns, except we're gonna do it with a little bit of a twist to the way that you normally hear it. So without further ado, I've been to the mountaintop, astounding. I'm surrounded by countless odds, so I'm working around the clock, and you know that the boy ain't about to stop. Okay, action. I don't need lights or cameras. I got passion. Don't wait for time to passion. Make it happen. You got to write the chapters as a habit. Tap into that tiger magic. If you wake up, the stripes don't panic. Classic fashion starts life as fabric. Nobody was born as a flying dragon. Load the cannon. Homie, light the matches. Boom. Got no time to waste. Exit room. Proceed to set the pace. Step in room. Proceed to set the pace, peep the tune, that's that victory taste. We're singing, we shall. Mm-hmm. see us through. The Lord will see us through. The Lord will see us through someday. I do believe that we shall overcome someday. Take it away. Let's give Ane and the homies another round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Okay. So my name is Taylor. I am the president of Black Student Union. This is what we got. So today we got a guest speaker. So Dr. Jackie Thompson recently retired from Davis School District as the director of Educational Equity Department. At Hill Air Force Base, Dr. Thompson worked as an equal employment opportunity specialist. She conceived and implemented the Hill Air Force Base African American Community Outreach Program. She also served as educational chair on the State Martin Luther King Jr. Human Rights Commission. She has received countless awards and recognition, including the 2017 Humanitarian Award for Inclusion Center in Salt Lake City. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jackie Thompson.
If I were to greet you in the African language of Swahili, I would say Jambo. If I were to greet you in Spanish, I would say hola. If I were to greet you in French, I would say bonjour. If I were to greet you in Navajo, I would say yate. If I were to greet you in Tongan, I would say mula lele. If I were to greet you in Samoan, I would say talofa. If I were to greet you in Japanese, I would say ohayo gozaimasu. But since I'm here with you outstanding students and staff, I'll simply greet you the way you greet one another and say, yo, sup, y'all. How's everyone doing? When I ask you how you're doing, I want you to say better than good and better than most. How's everyone doing?
Better than good and better than most.
Great, and sometimes better than that, right, homies? Okay. I wanted to first start by giving a special thanks to my friend Teo, who had done an outstanding job with the introduction. I met him several years ago at the University of Utah, along with at Westminster College last year with Expect the Great, where your BSU always does an outstanding job of representing Snow College. So let's give them a big shout out. I tell you, it is the truth that I've never heard a more beautiful rendition of We Shall Overcome. And the homies, you did a fantastic, phenomenal job. Let's give them another round of applause. Thank you. Beautiful. A special thanks to Mr. Fernando Montano, my friend and director of the Office of Diversity and Inclusion, and also to Professor Celia Benson. Again, to the BSU and the Expect the Great conferences that they're a part of, and to all of you who do a phenomenal job here in making a difference a reality. We're going to first start with a tribute from Westlake Junior High School students to Dr. King. They actually did this for a video contest one year for the State Office of Education. Following that, I will do a kind of performance to keep your eye on the prize, another great civil rights song, and then a portrayal, character portrayal of Rosa Parks, and then question and answers. Will that work?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so let's now hear Westlake Junior High School tribute to Dr. King.
Westlake Junior High, let me tell you about a special guy. His name was Martin Luther King. Ending discrimination, his thing.
He's a man that fought against segregation. If there's something he never had was intimidation, and living free was his motivation.
It didn't matter you were black or white, what was going in the 60s wasn't right. This man had a dream, you see, for all to have an equal opportunity.
Wasn't going to be easy, it seems, but the man had a dream, and when it came to freedom, he was the voice, and living free was his choice.
He wanted to let freedom ring all over the country and bring our hearts together as one. Gave his life before his work was done.
And because of him, we should celebrate, and if you are who you are, you should never hate. Living free was something he knew all about. He had a dream, so he wanted to work it out.
I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream.
Nonviolence is what he preached, and his message finally reached the hearts of all of us, but not before a big civil rights bus.
His speech is so crazy he could make a bird sing. His name, Martin Luther King, the man that made the freedom bells ring. Mr. King, here we are at the year 08, but back in the 60s, it wasn't so great. Back in the 60s, there was a man. All he needed to do was lend a hand.
But soon after America did change, some it seemed kind of strange. So far, we have come and changed the minds of more than some.
This man never really wanted fame. He just wanted to be treated the same. But we should all at least remember his name. We should all be sad for his death. Cause the man worked hard till his final breath.
We owe it to Martin Luther King for letting his voice ring. So brave was he. He gave his life for you and me.
Martin Luther King doing his thing. For the right thing, he had a dream.
We will be able to speed up that day when all children will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Now we'll hear Eye on the Prize. Began 62 years ago on December 1st, 1955, in Montgomery, Alabama, where segregation was alive and well and continued to show its ugly face. The kind of segregation I'm talking about is where people were treated differently just because of the color of their skin. White students and black students couldn't attend school together, eat at the same restaurants, or even drink from the same water fountains. There were signs marked white only for white customers and colored only for black customers. But there was one form of segregation that affected my life more than any other, and that was bus segregation. Blacks had to sit toward the back of the bus in a section marked colored, and if a white passenger got on, you had to get up and let that person sit down. On December 1st, 1955 in Montgomery, Alabama, something happened in my life that made history and changed America. Hello, my name is Rosa Parks. I am a seamstress. I had been working that day. I was waiting for the bus. The bus came. I got on, put my money in, went to the back to sit in the section marked colored. No sooner than I had sat down than the bus driver noticed that there was a white passenger standing. He told us to move. The others got up, but I refused. Now, children, I know the history books wrote that I didn't get up because my feet hurt and I was tired. My feet didn't hurt, and I wasn't tired. I was only 42 years old at the time. The only tired I was sick and tired of being treated differently just because of the color of my skin. When the bus driver noticed I didn't get up, he told me to get up right then and there. I told him no. He said if I didn't get up, he was gonna call the police and have me arrested and thrown in jail. I told him, fine, go ahead, do whatever you have to do, but I am not getting up today. Well, true to his word, he did call the police, And you know, when the police came, they pulled right up alongside that bus. And all while, that bus driver just kept fussing and kept yelling. Why, they even came on the bus to get me. And he pointed me out and he yelled and he said, "There she is! There's that gal that won't get up out of her seat. Get up, gal, for the day you're going to jail." Well, I was taken down to the jailhouse. I was arrested. I was fingerprinted. They even took my picture and charged me a $10 fine before they released me to go home. But I wasn't worried about it. God was always looking out for me. A young Baptist minister by the name of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was asked to head up the Montgomery bus boycott. He was only 26 years old at the time, very brave and courageous. Listen to what Dr. King had to say.
If we are wrong, the Supreme Court of this nation is wrong. If we are wrong, the Constitution of the United States is wrong. If we are wrong, God Almighty is wrong.
Now, Dr. King asked that we not ride that bus again until three things happened. Number one, courteous treatment from the bus drivers. Number two, seating on a first-come, first-served basis. And number three, hiring of black bus drivers. Blacks didn't ride the bus anywhere, to work, to town, to school. No, not even to church. Instead, the buses stood empty. Young people, as well as old people, walk long distances, and sometimes even in the rain. But on November the 13th, 1956, after almost one whole year of walking, praise the Lord, the United States Supreme Court ruled that the Montgomery bus segregation laws were unconstitutional. In other words, they were unfair. In the words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Now you see, I've always had a dream for young people, and that is that you stay in school and get a good education, because making a difference is your right and responsibility. What can you do to make a difference while you're in school? Do your best, help others, and become mentors, those that need it. Always say no to drug abuse, alcohol abuse, bullying, or harassment of any kind. Remember to show your neighbor love on a daily basis. In closing, I'd like to leave you with a poem. This poem is called Dreams by Langston Hughes. Before I say that, though, I want you to always stand up for your rights. Because in my case, I had to sit down, but you always stand up for your rights. Dreams. Hold fast to dreams, for if dreams die, life is a broken-winged bird that cannot fly. Hold fast to dreams, for if dreams go, life is a barren field covered with snow. Thank you, and may God bless you.
Hold on, hold on, hold on.
So before we go to questions, a tribute to Dr. King, there was a speech that he would do, and it was called The Drum Major Instinct. How many have heard of that one? The Drum Major Instinct. Every time I hear his I Have a Dream, and we'll hear this week and on Monday, which is Dr. King's birthday, January 15th, but I think about that. And on that Monday, remember that it's a day on and not a day off, and that all of us should continue to do what we can to make a difference. So Dr. King's talking, and it's long before he is assassinated. And he's at church, and he's doing a sermon, and he said, every now and then, I guess we all realistically think about that day when we'll be victimized with what is life's final common denominator. That's something we call death. Well, we all think about it, and every now and then, I think about my own death, and I think about my own funeral. And I don't do it in a morbid sense. And every now and then I ask myself, what is it that I'd once said? And I leave the word with you this morning. If you are around when I meet my day, I don't want a long funeral. And if you get somebody to preach the eulogy, tell them not to talk too long. And every now and then I wonder what I want them to say. Tell them not to mention that I have a Nobel Peace Prize. That isn't important. Tell them not to mention that I have 300 or 400 other awards. That's not important. Tell them not to mention where I went to school. I'd like someone to mention that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to give his life serving others. I'd like somebody to say that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to love somebody. I want you to say that day that I tried to be right on the war question. I want you to say that day that I did try to feed the hungry. I want you to be able to say that day that I did try in my life to clothe those who were naked. I want you to say on that day that I did try in my life to visit those who were in prison. I want you to say that I tried to love and serve humanity. Yes, if you want to say I was a drum major, say I was a drum major for justice. Say I was a drum major for peace. Say I was a drum major for righteousness. And all the other shallow things will not matter. I won't have any money to leave behind. I won't have the fine and luxurious things of life to leave behind. But I just want to leave a committed life. And that's all I want to say. If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or song, if I can show somebody he's traveling wrong, then my living will not be in vain. If I could do my duty as a Christian ought, if I can bring salvation to a world once wrought, if I could spread the message as the Master taught, then my living will not be in vain. And that was by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So at this time, I want to see if we have any questions. Any questions from the audience? And if we do, if you stand and tell me your name and what your major is, what your dream in life is, and then your question. I saw a hand right there. Let's see. Do you need the microphone?
No, I'm pretty loud.
Oh, you have a good teacher's voice.
Thanks.
Okay.
So what you're saying, and then what? I'm Jerem.
Jim, I'm sorry, yes. Your name, and what are you majoring in?
I'm majoring in business management.
Business management, and what's your dream in life?
I want to change the world. I have some big ideas for corporations I want to start. I have too much to explain right now, but yeah.
Oh, that's outstanding here. Okay, you're a world changer. That's outstanding. You're a positive one. And what's your question?
Jerem,
right? Thank you. That, come up this way, please, so they can see. That was a very good question. And so most of your family's Native American. Do you know which nation?
Mohawk.
Outstanding. Come on up this way, if you don't mind. And they're Mohawk. And you want to know what for others to take the high road so you can become an ally and you can continue to show them through your life love and to speak about it and to teach about it. We often do a training called REACH, Respecting Ethnic and Cultural Heritage, and we talk about multiple perspectives. So some of the family perceived it this way and others that way. Then we talk about culture as something everybody has. And then what you want to do with them is help build those cultural bridges. And then that will lead to head, heart, hands for healing. But you must be co-responsible in that way to where you would talk to them and explain to them, love is the way to go. That we are all God's children and that all of us are a gift and have something to offer in this world. Sometimes a lot of it is lack of awareness or someone not fully understanding or the way that history has shaped and painted everything, but to teach them a better way, to continue to love and teach them a better way and say, we're all part of one family, and that's the human family. But through your life and you being here and you speaking up, to continue to educate in a positive way. So being co-responsible, if you hear something that's like stereotypical or negative, you would say, oh, well, what makes you say that? And then you would listen, and then you would explain to them what that meant. But you would keep their dignity intact and your dignity intact because you always want to reach them where they are and bring them along. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you. May I have a hug?
That's excellent, okay. Absolutely.
Thank you, Kim. Thank you, God bless you. Jaron is going to change the world in a positive way. Okay. Do we have another? Yes, please. What's your name? Yeah, can stand up. If it's hard for you to, I can come to you. Okay. You're really quiet? Okay. You know, we often tell the teachers we make reasonable accommodations, and that's what the microphone does. And it costs little or no money, so a reasonable accommodation. Hi, what's your name?
I'm Julia.
Hi, Julia.
Oh, I didn't know it was off.
You need a Julia. Okay.
Hi, I'm.
Okay. Hi, I'm Julia.
Hi, Julia.
I am majoring in psychology, and I want to basically help people.
Great. Mm-hmm. That is outstanding, Julia. And I can
you.
Tell that you already help people. And
thank you.
What's your question? You're welcome.
What made you decide to stand up and be who you are today? What made you want to do what you're doing now?
Mm-hmm. Oh, Julia, good question. Julia asked, what made me want to stand up and do what I'm doing today? Julia, I wanted to make a change. I taught second grade in Pocatello, Idaho. And our students, we would teach them about respect and many other cultures, but I thought I had to be an example to them and let them know that they can grow up and make a positive difference in the world, but that they would have to speak up when they saw wrong of any kind, and they would have to say that's not right, but then they'd have to do something positive to change it. So I think becoming a teacher helped change, and then in Davis School District and across the state in our statewide REACH trainings, I think the thing that made me want to speak up was those five REACH basic principles. I knew for anything to change, I had to be co-responsible. So when I heard something wrong, I must speak up and stand up. So it was working with the students, and then working with our students in college and universities, and then working with our teachers, that we had to, if things were going to change and be better. We see all across the nation children being bullied, some on YouTube talking about how hurtful it is. And then we see people around the world reaching out to them saying, we stand with you. We stand with you, right? And then that it's enough is enough. So I knew that it was just something I wanted to do. I met Dr. King when I was 10. I saw him in Chicago. And then I saw Rosa Parks in Salt Lake a couple years ago. So role models like them and Gandhi, Mother Teresa, but most of all students like yourself who have always been a part of the civil rights movement from the very beginning. Students as young as 9 and 10 marched and went to jail with Dr. King. And when the world shone that light to see what students were doing, that's when the things begin to change. So for the students and for the youth in our generations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. May I have a hug? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. Wow. Some Outstanding questions. Do we have any other questions? Yes. Hi.
Hi.
What's your name?
Kaylee.
Hi, Kaylee. How are you doing today?
I'm good. How are you?
Oh, good.
So I'm an elementary education major.
Oh, great.
And my dream is to leave every person that I meet better than when I met them.
Oh, I love it.
So my question for you is, me personally becoming a teacher and you having worked actually in the same school district that I came from.
Oh, that's so wonderful.
I am wondering how I can incorporate, like, what can I incorporate into my classroom and in my daily life to help children and the people around me become more loving towards each other?
Okay, excellent question. Excellent. Which high school did you graduate from?
Yeah, Viewmont.
Viewmont. I love Viewmont Vikings. Okay, excellent. And you're going to be a teacher. We could use you back. So that'd be great in elementary education. I think as you go into the class, first step is let the students know how much you love them. Share with them who you are. So we would do an activity called the cultural bag. If you come this way, then we won't. Is that okay? Okay. As a teacher, you know we had to model this thing. Okay, so we would do cultural bags. So you could design your own cultural bag and tell the students that very first week who you are, have them design their own cultural bags too, and find out who they are. Value their culture, their families, everything that they bring, because they bring a lot, but you bring a lot. Everybody's a teacher and a learner. Put those bags up, or I am from poems, and then value who they are. But set the tone right away that I am valuable, that I am important to each child. Can I do an activity with you?
Yeah.
And how about if we have the audience stand with us and we'll go up here. Okay, would everyone stand, please? And it wouldn't hurt to do something like this at the beginning of each day with them, and it's called I Am Special. So if you'll repeat some words after me, okay? I am special.
I am special.
You are special.
You are special.
I respect you.
I respect you.
You respect me.
You respect me.
I see greatness in you.
I see greatness in you.
You see greatness in me.
You see greatness in me.
I am your neighbor.
I am your neighbor.
You are my neighbor.
You are my neighbor.
And I love you. Now give your neighbor a high five, and then audience, you may be seated. Kaylee, right? And Kaylee, just for just a teachable moment, if you're teaching the younger grades or even the older grades, you might put in there, and I like you. Because when they get to third grade and they're looking at each other, boys and girls, they don't want to say I love. You may say I like you in that part, but things along that route. And then if you give me your card afterwards, I can send you some materials as well, okay? Or your information. That was great. Thank you. Did that help answer? But just set the tone. Also, if a child comes and says, teacher, they called me a blank, whatever it is, then we've heard them say, sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me. But you want to say, they did what? And take each one serious and address it, because they said that that's not true. That words do hurt, and that we address it, and we say, that's not acceptable here. We don't use those words. We use kind and helpful words. We're a community, and we show love. So continuing to do that. Okay. Thank you. So happy. The businessmen and teachers, outstanding. Let's see, do we have another question? There she is, yes. Would you come down, please? I'll make a reasonable accommodation and come over this way and meet you. Okay. Well, it costs little and no money, right? Little and no money to make reasonable accommodations. Hi, what's your name?
My name is Sage.
Sage, that's a beautiful name.
Thank you.
Okay. Sage, what are you majoring in?
Right now I'm just trying to like get my generals, but I'm like working on in more psychology classes.
Wow, that's great. That was my favorite class, that psychology class. Okay, and what's your dream in life?
To make everyone know that they're like of worth and that they have something to do in the world no matter what they came from.
Wow, that is outstanding. Thank you.
Yeah.
And what question do you have?
So I have a couple, like at home, I have a couple of African American friends, and they've, you know, I've like taught to them, and they said that even though like they don't really get a lot of racism, they do, you know, still feel kind of excluded sometimes. I just want to know, as a, like, white and as just a friend, how to better include and better, like, accept and just love, like, the black community, because they deserve as much respect as anyone else does.
Wow, so. That is powerful. Let's give her a big hand. And where is home from you?
Colville, Utah.
Colville, Utah. Okay, excellent. So I would say that with your African-American friends that live in Colville?
Because there's only a couple of them, so like, they're very, like, they weren't like excluded, but you know, there's only like three or four, and like the school, everyone else is white, so it's kind of hard for them.
Okay, so I think I would value what they bring. I would ask them about their story and how they feel. I would include, make sure that whatever there's anything going on, that they felt welcome. Like, hey, would you like to try out for the play, or would you like to be a part of this, or you know? But I would, and I would ask them from time to time, you know, or have that relationship with them, where you guys are continuing building cultural bridges, and you would be asking questions, and then they would ask questions of you also. But I think you would just start with the basic common humanity of loving one another, but then valuing their culture and all, so that when Black History Month comes, they wouldn't be the spokesperson for Black History in February or for Martin Luther King in January, but that there could be something at the schools that honor that, to say a speaker comes in. Because our students will say, wow, can we have something for Black History Month or Women's History Month or Pacific Islander Month, or you know, that it's being acknowledged. Also, I would say around the schools that it should be reflective, even if it's a small population of African American or Native American or any other cultures, that the posters and the messages up on the walls reflect our diverse world in which we live in, and that as the teachers are teaching, that they're talking about diverse cultures as well. So I would just talk to your friends, learn about their culture, their heritage, what they bring, share with each other. Even those cultural bags and I Am From poems are wonderful to do in any discipline, and to find out more about each other. But just to be cognizant of what's going on and to celebrate, it's beyond a heroes and holiday approach, but it is still recognizing things that happen. For example, the whole world, the nation, will recognize Dr. King's birthday on Monday. But I think just always being aware of what can we do to be more inclusive of others that are in our environment, and being friends and always welcoming. I think just even to get that invitation page, like say we're going to the movies, do you want to come? You know, just, I mean, proms and dates and everything else. Sometimes people will feel excluded, but always welcoming and inviting them to come, and others. We tell the children that lunchtime is as simple as sitting in the lunchroom, and some people are by themselves of any race or gender, and making sure that no one's alone, that we're all there supporting one another. But I would just think to express that friendship, tell them I'm very happy you're here. They're not the spokesperson for the whole race, but that what they bring is value. And we're not colorblind, because sometimes we say, oh, well, I don't see color, and that means I'm not going to discriminate against you based on your race. However, I do see color. Oprah Winfrey said, if I don't see color, I don't see you. So I see your beautiful hair, it's kind of blondish brown. I see your beautiful eyes, they're blue, right? Okay, I see your beautiful shirt and your really neat boots. I see color, and I value that color. And so, when we say colorblind, that doesn't help anybody. Value and accept what people bring. We don't discriminate based on it. But we are different. It says it's our diversity that brings us closer. Our commonality brings us closer together, and our diversity enriches us. Paige, that was a great question. Did it help? Did that answer? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you, Paige. Well, I think we have time for one more. Thank you. I see you right there. We have time for one more. And here he is. Come on down. The price is right. I used to like that show. I have to tell you, me and my husband tried to get on there. And we went to LA, but Drew Carey got sick. And we went back to Utah. We'll try it again. Hi, what's your name?
I'm Zach.
Hi, Zach. How are you doing?
Doing great. How are you?
Oh, great. What's your major in?
I'm just getting my associate's right now.
Oh, that's outstanding. What's your dream in life?
I want to protect and serve.
Oh, that's outstanding. Will you go into military or will you be an officer?
Law enforcement is the plan.
Law enforcement. I thank you for the service. And I thank you for being a lifesaver. I got to hug you right up front. protect and serve. I love it. It's beautiful. Anna, what's your question?
So I know that you have a background in education and equality. When it comes to higher education, what's your opinion or view on, affirmative action and a merit-based acceptance system?
Okay, so as we think about affirmative action, years ago with affirmative action, the door was closed, and so people of color and females couldn't get in the door. So let's see, is it Max?
Zach.
Okay, Zach, what affirmative action did, it just opened the door a little bit, and then a few people came through, and it benefited mostly white females and continues right now. I think that any group that is underrepresented should be represented. I believe that if people are equally qualified and there's underrepresentation going on, for example, males that are in elementary education were very underrepresented. So you have a male teacher, female teacher coming through, and you've got a huge number of female teachers and they're equally qualified, bring the male teacher in. You have people that are differently abled, that are highly qualified too, bring that person in. Diversify the workforce as much as possible. And many times, we don't want affirmative action to work where people aren't qualified getting in. We're saying if people are just as qualified and there's any form of underrepresentation, I'll go with education because I know. Yeah. But in secondary, we need more females, administrators and all. So you have a female that's equally qualified and you have a large number of male, bring that female in because it enriches that population. And it shows to the students that we value all of you and we have representation. Same with race. The more diversified you are. Today we visited your multicultural center. It was beautiful. I saw students of all backgrounds. And I thought, this is what it is. It's about richness. It's about educational equity. Educational equity is you have three children about this high, and that high looking over the fence at a baseball game. And then the one that's smaller, you put a box there and level the playing field so they can see too. So it's like leveling that playing field and giving children what they need. Do you wear glasses?
No.
No. So I shouldn't give you these glasses to see, right?
No.
Right? So educational equity is giving you what you need. And then leveling the playing field for all so they have what they need as well. But with the affirmative action and merit base and the things that you talked about, it's not to take away from one group to give to another group, but it makes all of us stronger together.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
It does. I have one kind of follow-up question.
Sure. Okay.
Just to clarify, make sure
follow-up question. Okay.
So I guess the follow-up question is, maybe I'm not quite familiar enough with affirmative action. Does it rely on quotas?
It used to have those quotas that were in there, and sometimes there is quotas. I know at the University of Utah Medical School, say there were 200 positions to get in. 10 might have been set aside for students of color because they didn't have very many. But that meant 190 were there for other students already. So what they were saying is, we've got a diverse nation and a population, and we want to make sure we serve that population. And we're so underrepresented, we're going to put some spaces aside for these students to come in. But it still usually is a small percentage, and it still doesn't take away from anyone else, in my opinion. That was in my opinion. Okay, any other questions?
Okay, thanks for sharing your view with me.
You're so welcome, Zach. Thank you. And thanks for your hug and for serving and protecting. Thank you. Thank you, guys. I'm so happy and so honored to be here today. And I failed to mention that my husband Mr. Ed Thompson's here with me. Can you give a shout out? Okay. His claim to fame was that he beat his team at ISU, beat UCLA. They played in the NCAA championship in 77. And so they was played right not too far away at BYU 40 years ago. So, but he travels around with me. He loves coming and being with our students. So I thank you guys. And I believe that time is, they made a reasonable accommodation. I had this, you know, you see this clock. And so I just wanted to thank you for allowing us to be here today at Snow College. This is our second time here coming to Ephraim. We love it, and I promise you it won't be our last time. So thank you, and may God bless you in all that you do. Thank you.
Snow College and the Black Student Union, we would like to thank you for your wisdom and for sharing everything that you know with us.
Wow, thank you so much.
Thank you.